Okay, so hi everyone, and thanks for being here. The second course of about cat codes. So I'm gonna just start from where I left off the last time a few days ago. And so as I was mentioning, we are gonna be considering these bosonic codes from the point of view of non-locality in the phase space, rather than somehow how to pack as much as we can information in a given Hilbert space of these systems. So I finished off with explaining somehow very rapidly the idea of the GKP encoding. And what we saw is that even in the perfect situation of a perfect measurement and infinitely squeezed GKP codes, we're going to be ending up and with error models which are like Gaussian noise, like Gaussian displacement, uniform Gaussian displacement in the phase space. We're going to be by the end of the day be limited by some error probability, which is going to be somehow the probability that during the time of measurement you have diffused more than the value square root of pi in one direction, q or p, momentum or position. And so that's going to be basically it might be very small, but it's still there. So you might basically see this as this protected bosonic mode. You can see it as a very much improved qubit, basically. And then later on, if you want to have still better qubits, you have to basically encode this in a bigger code, in a different code, like you saw perhaps with Barbara Terhal. You can put it in a surface code, for example, consider it as an ingredient of a surface code. And then even improve better the thing. So the fact is that you start from much better qubits, so you'll have much less overhead to scale towards a surface code. Okay, so that's one property. The question is that is it possible to use this bosonic mode somehow in a more scalable manner, in the sense that you want to use something which becomes larger and larger in this in a single bosonic mode, and improve better and better something, so that maybe you don't actually need this kind of second layer of protection. Unfortunately, the answer is no. As I mentioned, it's just that if you basically make things more non-local in the phase space in one direction, you're gonna make them more local in the other direction. So it's still we're gonna still try and to undo that, and you're gonna see why. Basically, we're gonna be able to make so these lectures are about making use of such very asymmetric situation. Basically, we try to protect very well in the bosonic mode against one type of error, and the expense of increasing the other type of error. The nice property is that we're gonna be basically removing one error exponentially well in the size of the code, whereas the other error is going to be only increased linearly in this size. And then the question is that can we put this whole thing in a much simpler code than a surface code and have some protection, full protection over this system? So that's basically the general plan of this kind of proposal that I'm going to be talking about. And the nice property that we're going to see on the third lecture is that it actually enables us to do topologically protected gates, which are universal, including non-Clifford gates, for which you need magic state distillation stuff with this surface code, without any requirement of magic states, basically, with this kind of structure. And the idea is that, well, you use the phase space of a harmonic oscillator as a 2D system, and then by just the linear chain of these 2D systems, you have actually a 3D system, and it gives you some new possibilities on performing some topologically protected gates that are not accessible with a simple surface scope, which is 2D. Okay, so that's let me just this was just maybe a plan of what we're gonna see through the two lectures that are gonna follow up. So, well, let's start with just providing the what are the ingredients. So we're gonna get back to this cat. The only thing that we're gonna do is that we're going to use actually simpler cats than the ones that we saw. We're going to use actually two component cats now. So basically, the two Schrödinger cat states that we're going to be using is what I call cat alpha plus and minus, which are basically some superposition, even an odd superposition of two coherent states, plus alpha and minus alpha. Okay, with the normalization, which I told you was given by 1 over square root of 2, 1 plus or minus exponential minus 2 alpha squared. So basically, this normalization is very close to 1 over square root of 2, exponentially close to the size of the cat. Okay, and then, so this is basically what I'm going to call the plus or minus states of a cat encoding. So basically, the 0 and 1 encoding of a cat encoding is going to be just the superposition of these two states. These two states are now orthogonal because they are even and odd superpositions of Fock states. So basically, they are exactly orthogonal, cat plus and cat minus. And so what I call the 0 encoding of my cat is going to be this state. And the 1 encoding is going to be the 1 state. It's going to be this new state. And basically, this is, you can see very easily that this is very close to the alpha. Basically, it's close up to an O of exponential minus 2 alpha squared. And this is minus alpha plus some O of exponential minus 2 alpha squared. OK, so basically, you see already that we have, if you look at the phase space, we have two coherent states, basically alpha and minus alpha, which is basically this 0 and 1 states, which are rather far from each other, and which could be made farther and farther from each other in this phase space as much as you want, basically. Okay, so one thing which is going to be nice and which basically going to be subject of the talk today is that we're going to be seeing that these states actually could be stabilized quite efficiently, in the sense that we could basically engineer a kind of interaction with the environment such that we have basically in the phase space a dynamics which has a bistable situation, so which has these two states as steady states, so that basically any local error which would want to shift this coherent state towards anywhere in this right plane, basically, would bring it back, would be brought back to this coherent state alpha, and the same thing for the other one. And so basically what we're going to try to show that is that with this process, we're going to have actually an exponential suppression of the bit flip error. So bit flips are going to be the jumps between this state and this state, and vice versa. We're going to prove that we for reasonable error channels, so reasonable, I'm going to define it later, we're going to have some exponential suppression of this bit flip error channel, the bit flip error mechanism. Of course, if you have an error mechanism which directly couples the two coherent states, you're not going to be protected against those kind of mechanisms. But I don't know of such a mechanism for now. I can tell you how you can engineer such a mechanism on purpose, but you can say that, well, these actually should not happen in nature, at least in a natural situation. Basically, you need very high impedance elements to get such kind of non-local interactions, and I'm going to talk about that maybe at the end if we have time. Okay. So what is the idea behind this stabilization? Well, the idea is actually quite simple. You know that if you have a driven damped harmonic oscillator, which actually is stabilized around the coherent state, so it converges towards the coherent state, right? So, well, let me just write the master equation. So for a driven damped harmonic oscillator, let's say it's driven at resonance, so I go to a rotating frame, I do rotative approximations and stuff, and I get something like minus some epsilon drive, exponential minus I phi of drive, a dagger, plus a exponential I rho this is, let's say, the Markovian model for a driven damped harmonic oscillator. So with where the dissipation is at a happens at a rate kappa 1, so this is the Lindblad-ian, as you know, and this is the Hamiltonian of the drive, where you have the amplitude and the phase of the drive encoded in this master equation, right? And I guess that you know that this system, this density matrix, should converge down towards, let's say, basically coherent state alpha infinity, where alpha infinity is given by basically exponential minus I e b, so it's going to be actually, sorry, minus 2i. Epsilon d divided by kappa 1. So if I haven't made a mistake, it should be that you get. Okay? So basically, you see that you converge where the coherent state, where the amplitude and phase of the coherent state is basically controlled by the phase of the drive and the amplitude of the drive. Okay? It's 1. This one?
Yeah.
I've written 1. Let's call it 1 photon. You're going to see later why I'm using this notation. Okay, so it's basically this a single photon dissipation of a harmonic oscillator. Okay. Okay, well, the idea of this kind of stabilization is just that in this system, if somehow you had a way to replace every operator A by A squared, that's exactly what you would do. So basically, if you had some system where you had engineered this kind of dynamics, a dagger squared exponential minus I phi d, here I use 2 photons because it's going to be exchange of 2 photons, a squared rho a dagger squared minus 1 half of a dagger squared a squared rho minus 1 half of rho a dagger squared a squared. Then this system, you can show that this rho is necessarily going to converge towards a manifold, which is the span of 2 coherent states with opposite signs. Infinity, let's call it. And the alpha infinity here is given by basically the same thing in a square root. So it's going to be just the square root of this whole thing. And there is a plus and there is a plus and minuses already here, so it's basically minus 2i exponential minus I phi d epsilon d. Yes, you could. Yes, it's maybe better notation. I do agree. And this is the epsilon 2 photon. That's true. I would call this also. It's a better notation. Okay. So I could use this other notation. Clarify that these are different drives, different dissipations. Okay. So basically, we'll see later how we can engineer such a system. But let's assume for now that we have such a basically driven damped harmonic oscillator, where we exchange photons with the drive and with the environment in pairs only. Okay. So now I'm gonna try at the beginning. I'm gonna try to show that such a. Let's see. I told you that we're gonna converge towards this span of plus and minus alpha infinity, but I don't tell you how. Can I identify which state in this span I'm going to converge to, right? I start from any state, let's say, in my phase space, and I ask where do I end up with. There are some states where this is trivial. If you start from vacuum and you do this, you're necessarily going to converge towards the even cat state, alpha plus minus alpha. Do you see why? Yes, because the parity, there is a question of parity of number of photons, right? You change photons in pairs. You start from an even number, of photons, so which, because you start from vacuum. So you have to end up with a state which has an even number of photons in it. And the only superposition of coherent states alpha minus alpha with an even even parity is the is the cat plus state, basically. It's alpha plus minus alpha. There is no other choice. If you start from Fock state number one, you necessarily converge towards the odd Fock state, so alpha minus minus alpha. Okay. So this is the concept of an invariant of the dynamics. Basically, the parity of number of photons is an invariant of this dynamics. So in order to basically, what we know is that we're going to converge towards a density matrix which is defined. So we have a density matrix rho infinity, which is being given by some, let's say, something like this. I would call it actually cat plus. I have used this notation, I think. Cat plus alpha, cat plus alpha, plus cat minus, c minus minus, cat alpha minus, cat, I don't know whether I use the notation in one direction or the other. I change sometimes, so yeah, I have put alpha in. Cat alpha minus, cat alpha minus. And then you have the C plus minus, cat alpha minus, plus complex conjugate, right? So this is density matrix in this, basically in this Hilbert space, can be written always in this form, because these two states are two orthogonal states, so two basis states of this space, and any density matrix is necessarily of this form. Where you have some properties, of course, C plus 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 C minus minus should be one, to the trace of this thing. And then the matrix should be positive, right? The matrix which is C plus plus, C minus minus, C plus minus, and C plus minus star. This matrix should be positive, so you need to satisfy that as well. No, these are exactly orthogonal, right? These two states are exactly orthogonal because these are even an odd superposition of Fock states. So when you write them in the basis of Fock states, they have only even Fock states or odd Fock states. So even though alpha and minus alpha are not precisely orthogonal, these states are precisely orthogonal. Okay. So this, in these notations, basically we want to find, for a given initial state, we want to find these four coefficients to know where we're going to end up with. And this is something which is feasible. I'm not going to show how. But basically, you can define three invariants. So one invariant is the parity. In the notes, you can look in the notes for the details of that. And then there are two other invariants, which are quite complicated, which Victor Albert had came up with, which is you can look at the forms in the notes. But I mean, you can use them to basically guess where you're going to end up. There may be more harder to understand. So, but the first one, which, as I said, is just this observable. This is an invariant operator. So basically, this observable is going to be conserved. This is the parity, the population of even Fock states, basically, which is of course one minus the population of odd Fock states. So this is one, the first one. But there is two other ones, as I mentioned. So there is some g plus minus, which is a complex number. So it has two components, which is defined in the notes. I leave it to you to look at this, but this is much more complicated. And this is, you can use these three basically invariants, so this real one and this complex one basically, to see where you're going to end up if you start from a given initial state, because these values should be conserved. We have three values to identify because we have C plus plus and a complex number. Basically, C minus minus is going to be given by one minus this thing. So we have three unknowns and three conserved quantities. And with that, we can basically find these three numbers. OK, that's the way you can identify basically the steady state of your system. And so you can apply this method and, for example, ask yourself where I'm going to end up if I start from a coherent state which is not far from this one. OK? So let's say that I consider a coherent state. So I consider an initial state, rho 0, which is basically plus or minus alpha plus some epsilon. Okay, so I started from a coherent state, which is shift, some shift. Epsilon is a complex number, which might be not so big, which it might be actually, it's going to be something of order one, let's say, at most. And then you ask, where am I going to end up if I start from this state? You do calculations, and what you can show is that rho infinity is going to be given by basically the same plus minus alpha with the same plus and minus as your initial one, plus some O of exponential minus C alpha squared times the other one, minus plus alpha minus plus alpha. So basically, if I have erased this. So if I start basically here, I mainly going to converge towards this one, this state, plus with some probability converging towards the other coherent state. But this probability is going to be given by exponential of minus C alpha squared, okay, where C is a constant. Okay, so basically what it means is just that if I make this cat bigger and bigger, with the same distance, epsilon being constant, I'm going to be more and more probable to converge towards this state than this state. And this is exponentially changing, basically. And the question is, what is this constant C? You can show that actually for epsilons which are between 0 and 1 half, this C is very close to 1, 2, 2. So basically, you have an exponential of minus 2 alpha squared probability that of converging. So it's quite a big number, actually. So if you put, let's say, a cat of size, I don't know, alpha equals to 3 or 2 or 3, you get exponential minus 18, for example. You have a very small probability of converging towards the others. Yes?
I'm a bit lost in the notation. Infinity means time evolution to an
arbitrary. Exactly. So it's you wait for infinite time, and you ask, where am I going to end up? I don't have any other dynamics. I just have these two photon-driven dissipative system. I start from a basically dephase state or some state which has been shifted by epsilon, and I wait for infinity, and I ask, where am I going to end up? And this is going to be basically the result.
So following up on that, what's the relationship between the alpha infinities and the C alpha minus
E plus? I'm sorry. So yeah, that's true. It's in this notation, it's C alpha infinity, if you want. So this is the end, the final values. Yeah, so we're going to end up with this alpha infinity. So yes, from now on, I'm going to use alpha as being everywhere alpha infinity, you see alpha infinity, it's actually alpha. I'm going to use beta for whatever else. So
okay.
I'm sorry, yes, that's a good point. So here is alpha infinity. Okay. So that's quite nice. But as I told you here, if it seems like we have to wait till infinity, of course, we have to wait a long time. What is this time that you have to wait for which, so that you, I mean, what's the rate at which you converge towards this, basically, state? That's another question that we might ask ourselves. Because what does it mean? It means just that we're connecting any shifts towards this state, but at which rate, at which speed are we correcting this? That's an important question, because then we have to compare this to this to the rate at which the errors happen, okay? Okay, so that's gonna be the second thing that I'm gonna show here. It's gonna actually be quite nice as well. So the idea is that we can define what is called the Lyapunov function. Okay, so it becomes a little bit more mathematical. So if I consider some function v of rho, which depends on rho, which is given by trace of a squared minus alpha squared rho a squared minus alpha squared dagger. Okay, so you might ask where does it come from? Well, we'll see it in a bit. Okay, let me just actually maybe make a something in parenthesis before getting back to there. Just let me say you that this whole thing, this big master equation, you can write it in a different manner as well. you can write it in this form. Exponential minus kappa 2, this is plus, I'm sorry, this is a plus here. Kappa 2 photon, A squared minus alpha squared, rho, A squared minus alpha squared dagger, minus A squared minus alpha squared dagger, A squared minus alpha squared rho, minus 1/2 of rho, A dagger squared minus alpha, minus alpha squared dagger, A squared minus alpha squared. So basically it's just the same Lemledian. It's like kappa 2 photon. In the notations that we use usually it's a Lemledian with the operator A squared minus alpha squared applied at rho. Okay? So where alpha is basically what I had given here. So this is the alpha infinity value. Okay? Basically you can regroup terms in this master equation, and this boils down to this maybe simpler looking master equation with a single Lemblad operator, which is A squared minus alpha squared. And you see from here why alpha and minus alpha are steady states of this thing. It's quite easy, because if you put alpha here, A squared minus alpha squared times alpha or minus alpha gives you zero, right? If you apply A squared minus alpha squared to the state plus or minus alpha, you get zero, right? So that's why this whole steady state has this whole, yes, again, as I said, from now on, just forget about infinity, it's alpha. yes. No, this is really a regrouping of terms. This is really no, so basically the only thing that you do, there is no transformation. Here I haven't done any use to the transformation. If you just write this, if you develop this thing, you can write it, regroup terms and find it. Yes. So here, I'm saying that the drive amplitude is coming in this alpha. So if you just use this formulation, put it here, and you develop these things, you can see that these two are exactly equal. There is no transformation or anything. Okay. So this is maybe nicer rewriting of the same master equation, because you see very rapidly that the two coherent states are the two steady states of the system. So keep this in mind, and that's, now let's go back to this Lyapunov function. So why we call, what is a Lyapunov function for us? Usually in the dynamical system theory math, a Lyapunov function is a function which is positive, semi-definite positive, basically. You see very easily that this is positive, because you see rho is a positive matrix. You multiply with the matrix and its conjugate from both sides, it has to remain positive, right? Because when a matrix is positive, you can write it in some form of A dagger A. And then this is like this whole thing times this whole thing. It's like the square of a matrix, so it's necessarily a positive matrix. Okay? You could just say that if I develop this thing and I look at the eigenvalues do not change. So, I mean, the eigenvalues have to remain positive. They could change, but they could, because A squared minus alpha squared is not a unitary, but they have to remain positive. Okay, so this whole thing is positive. It's quite easy to see. The nice thing is that V is equal to zero, V of rho equals to zero, is equivalent to saying that rho is in the span of plus or minus alpha. Basically, this thing becomes zero only if rho is a superposition or a mixture of alpha and minus alpha. Okay? And the nice property is that if you look at the derivative of this Lyapunov function, you can show that it is, and you put the dynamic of rho in it, you can see that this is always decreasing. Trace, yes, I'm sorry. The trace of A squared minus, so it's a real number, which is always positive, yes? Belongs, yes, I'm sorry. Belongs to the suspense. So that's what I said. So saying it's a function which is semi-definite positive, which takes its the value zero only on the points towards which you want to show that you converge. And then you look at the derivatives of this Lyapunov function, it should be always negative. And you can make that this is satisfied. And it's actually what we call a strong Lyapunov function, because what we're gonna show is that the derivative of V is something like minus some constant times V. So So it's an exponentially converging to zero. It's some quantity which converges exponentially fast to zero, actually.
That is a trace, right?
Trace, yes. Okay. So I'm sorry, it's going to be a little bit mathematical at the beginning.
No, fine.
Yes. So what we can show actually is that, so d over dt of v of rho, basically, at least if you start from rows which are coherent states, let's say some beta, you can show it that this is equal to minus 2 kappa 2 photon, 1 plus 2 beta squared v of rho. So basically, what does it say? Is that it says that if you start from a coherent state, this v is going to be decreasing at a rate which is given by kappa 2 photon times something which increases with the scat size as well. Okay. So if you're locally around the coherent state alpha, this rate is close to basically minus 2 kappa 2 photon, 1 plus 2 alpha squared, basically. So if you start from a coherent state which is close enough to the coherent state alpha, this is basically the rate you have. So what do we have shown? We have shown that if we start from a small displacement of coherent state plus alpha, we're going to essentially converge towards plus alpha with some exponentially small probability of converging towards minus alpha. And this convergence happens at a rate which is also increasing itself with the size of the cap with alpha. That's true, but this is a much more, so if you start from anywhere in the phase space, this rate is not as good. The rate you can, what you can show is that this thing is still exponentially decreasing, but the rate is going to be only kappa 2 photon, which is normal somehow, because if you start from a vacuum state, this beta is equal to zero. Basically, you don't have any dependence on alpha. But if you start around your coherent state, okay, then this is different. Then around your coherent state, you're going to have an exponentially fast convergence with a rate which depends on alpha. But it's like if you look at your vector fields, the value of the vector fields are much, much stronger. So if you consider this, basically you have like these two small vector fields. So if you look at this classically, this is your two coherent states, plus alpha and minus alpha. The thing is that these basically arrows increase in size when you get close to alpha. So the rate of convergence towards alpha is much stronger when you're around alpha than when you're far from alpha. That's the way you could say it. It's a nonlinear, it's even if it's a linear system, but actually we are, you can look at it as a nonlinear thing, because this, I mean, you know, it's quantum systems are fake linear systems, basically, because somehow you are forgetting the fact that everything is living on a manifold which is highly nonlinear. So, is it a little bit? So, if when you look at the Langevin equations, you can replace the Langevin equations by some classical equations of motion, and this is going to be looking like this. It's a nonlinear equation with a vector field which has a stronger components when you get close to your coherent states alpha and minus alpha. That's the way you can understand.
I guess I'm confused by the fact that if beta becomes very, very large, then
this should be even.
Be even.
Yes, exactly. So if you start from here, it's even much. So when you start from far away, then you are very rapidly decaying towards this thing. But when you're around zero, you converge slower towards that. That's the way you could understand this whole thing.
Could you tell me what would I find out if I would do the classic, the standard thing and look at the first non-zero eigenvalue? Would I find something very different?
Yeah, yeah, you would find kappa 2 photon, basically.
Right.
You don't find kappa 2 photon times alpha squared.
Okay.
You will still converge exponentially, but this exponential is not increasing with the size of the cat. But that's not a big problem either. I mean, that's still quite good for some kind of error channels. For some other error channels, it's not that good. It depends on what kind of error channel you want to correct. Yes?
I would think that if you make your cat stay bigger and bigger, which means more and more photons, you will be prone to losing more photons faster.
Exactly. So there is that's why I'm saying that's the question, is that if you want to have sometimes faster protection to go against faster errors as well, somehow. But this is naturally, this two-photon dissipation has naturally a faster dissipation when you get a larger cat size. So for some kind of error mechanisms which go faster and faster when you get them higher and higher, larger and larger, basically you win by such kind of mechanism. Okay? That's the way you could understand this. Yes? Yes, so okay, that's true. So you say that V converges exponentially to zero, but what does it mean that rho converges exponentially fast to alpha and minus alpha? Well, yeah, I mean, this is because V is basically a continuous function of rho, and rho becomes zero only at alpha and minus alpha. Then an exponential convergence of V towards zero is also an exponential convergence of rho towards this space. Because if it's a continuous function, you can say that at around, you can have a small neighborhood around these states. You can do the math, it's not a problem. But this is basically the concept of Lyapunov functions. If you have a Lyapunov function which is well done, which means it's continuous, it takes only value zero at your steady state, then its exponential convergence towards zero means the exponential convergence of your state towards your steady state. Okay? Yes, yeah, we can see this. Basically it's kind of a norm or kind of a distance. It's kind of a distance, I would say, because you could define many kind of distances between one state and the final state that you want to converge to, right? You could consider the norm of the fidelity, but you could also define this. This is also a valid distance. And that's the distance for which we can show exponential convergence, and that's fine enough. So yes, let me just get there. This is going to be basically what I'm going to show. I'm going to show that basically we're going to be in a winning situation when we get them large because of these two properties. So the two properties that I've shown is just that if you start in the neighborhood of alpha, you converge towards alpha essentially with an exponentially small thing on minus alpha. And this happens at a rate which is given by basically kappa 2 photon times alpha squared somehow, something like that. These are the two properties I'm going to use. So let me now consider some error mechanisms, like as you wanted to know. So for example, some physical ones. The first one I'm going to start is the single photon damping, basically the major decay channel of a harmonic oscillator, which is the damping of the losing one photon. So basically, my dynamics is not exactly this, but I have also some single photon dissipation that I had suppressed, right? So protection against basically a photon loss channel, single photon loss channel, if you want. So if you remember from the last lecture, we said that if we look at time, so if we start from an initial state rho t, and then we propagate the system with this decay channel over time tau, I told you that this, we can write it as a sum of some cross operators. So k going from 0 to infinity, ek rho ek dagger divided by, there is no divided. Ek rho ek dagger, where the eks, you remember this, was were given by the square root of 1 minus exponential minus tau divided by t cav, basically the time of the to the power k factorial k exponential minus tau divided by 2 t cav a dagger a to the power k. So you remember this thing that I wrote last time. So basically, what does it say? It's each of these error mechanisms can be seen as k jumps, a shrinking of energy with this value, and with this given probability, basically. Square of this is going to be the probability of that. Okay? So, so what I'm going to do, do you remember when I told you about this continuous quantum error correction? I told you continuous quantum error correction could be seen as small steps of error and small steps of correction. So my small steps here are going to be this time, 1 over this time, basically. Basically, I'm saying that this is the time for which my correction, error correction mechanism brings me back to the good manifold, basically, corrects for errors. So the tau that I'm going to choose here, I'm going to choose it of the order or proportional to 1 over alpha squared kappa 2 photon. Basically, that's the time along which, so I assume that this is the kind of discretization of my error mechanism that I'm going to assume. I'm going to say that over a time of this order, I let it propagate with this error mechanism, and then I apply my error correction at once, and I go back to some state, and I look at what is my final state. That somehow can calculate in this manner the effective, basically, error mechanism that you have. Okay? It's some kind of discretization of your error mechanism. You can see it as kind of trotterization, if you want, of some two, you have two error mechanisms happening at the same time. One of them is the error mechanism, the other one is the recovery mechanism, because basically, you have this two photon driven dissipation on at the same time as you have the single photon dissipation on. So you can basically trotterize these two dynamics. You say that over some small amount of time, I have this happening, and then this happening, and then this happening, and this happening. And that's the way you can understand the whole thing. Okay? So,
is that an approximation? Or is it
it's an approximation, right, which is as good as this over basically. You can make this time going smaller and smaller, but it's not. So it's as good as your trotterization basically.
Yeah, trotterization can spoil very easily if you don't take into account different dynamics. I'm just wondering that.
No, this is this is an approximation which works quite well because you have a stable systems basically. The thing is that, of course, if you have things that when you approximate things which are not converging towards something, and then you might have a very weird phenomena because of higher order terms, they could basically give you big drives. But here, if you have, basically, it's like having a matrix A. If you consider a system which is x dot equals to AX, okay, where A is a huge, is a matrix with all negative eigenvalues. So it's a stabilization from it. Then you come and you basically disturb this A by a epsilon B, where this B is a perturbation to A. You're not going to change the eigenvalue. So basically, the properties of convergence are not going to be affected by this kind of perturbation. So usually when you have a stable system with a rate of convergence, you don't worry much about perturbations of that system. That's a robustness issue, basically. Exactly. So you need to still. Even if you're far away, this is still true. The thing is just that the rates are not the same. So A. Exactly. Not 1 over kappa 2 alpha squared. We'll have to see. I mean, it depends on the particular error. We haven't seen yet, but yes, it might be. It depends on whether this increases. Yes.
It depends on how the evolution
exactly. So you could have situations where it becomes infinitely fast at a very high. So this is going to be this is a quite a well-behaved dynamics. But if you consider a dephasing channel, for example, that goes much faster, and that's going to be actually a problem if you don't have this, for example. Okay. But let's get there. Okay. Okay. So. No, I'm not. So my master equation, if you want, I write it here, is now this d of a squared minus alpha squared, as I had before, rho. And I had added some single photon spurious, basically, dissipation, which is this. Basically, this I don't want to have it, but I have it, unfortunately. And this is the one I have engineered myself. So this is my dynamics. Okay? Yeah, you could also study this new equation, but that's the way I'm gonna prove things is by this discretization of the error. So basically, I told you I have a proof that if I don't have this kind of system, if I don't have these perturbations, basically, my system converges locally towards the good state and at that particular rate. And now I want to show that if I add these perturbations, it still works quite well, yeah. And it can only induce bit flip errors. Basically jumps from alpha to minus alpha, which are exponentially small in rate.
Yes, but I don't quite understand why you have to go through a quadrization.
I don't know any other way. So if you have another, so yeah, there might be another possible. I mean, this is just basically study of that these dynamical systems, and you want to do this for quite general. So this here I'm considering this, but the same method I'm going to use it for other type of errors later on. So, but. It's basically a general method that you say that you see the error correction mechanism working. So basically, as I told you, the continuous error, this is a continuous quantum error correction mechanism where you can see it as like small steps of error correction, error correction, error correction. And that's the way I show that this should work. And then, of course, then this is the job of experimentalists to show that it works. And hopefully we have a poster tonight by Raphael and Zaki tomorrow is going to give a talk showing that it actually works. Practice, but so let's just to give an idea of why it works. Okay, so yes, let's say so we have this mechanism. So the question is that I start from the coherent state alpha. Okay. Or plus or minus alpha, or it could be minus alpha, but this I write everything for alpha, but you can do the same thing for minus alpha, because everything is symmetric. I let it evolve with this cross channel, and then I apply my my error correction mechanism. So it's basically my rho zero is this projection state, which is basically the plus state of my the zero state of my my CAD code, basically. I let it evolve with the error mechanism. And then I apply the correction mechanism, and I ask where do I end up? Okay, that's basically the mechanism that we're gonna look at. The error correction is basically the turning on. So as I told you, basically my error mechanism is this, and my error correction mechanism is this. So I turn on this for a while, then I turn on this for a while, then I turn this on for a while, and then turn this for a while. Again, as I said, it's like kind of a trivialization. It's kind of a discretization of this whole master equation. You can say that everything is on at the same time. Yeah. But the way we're going to study it is by saying that, let's say, over a small amount of time, I have this on, and over the same small amount of time, I have this on. Okay, this is an approximation, of course. No, it does not. Yes, exactly. But so the question is that at which rate it mixes everything? That's what we want to show. So if, okay, let me say what we would have observed if this had simulated this. So if I had the slides, I could have shown you first the simulation results. But the simulation is, what happens is just this. You're gonna start from this state, and you're gonna see that you're gonna eventually, at some rate, you're gonna have a mixture of alpha and minus alpha. The question is at which rate this is gonna happen. Okay, so you start from here, you're gonna see this one turning on, and at the end of the dynamics, you're gonna have half population in alpha, half population minus alpha. The question is that this happens at what rate? That's what I want to calculate, okay? So, okay, so if I start from this state and I wait for this amount of time, which is given here, basically I get to something which is proportional. I get to this sum, so sum of ek rho k, ek rho ek daggers. Well, let me look at each of these ek rho ek daggers. This is basically proportional, I just forget about this part. To what? Well, the application of A operator is just multiplying by some alpha k. It's applied on both sides, so it's alpha to the power 2k, basically. So I apply ak and ak dagger on both sides of alpha alpha. So that just gives me alpha to the power 2k. And this thing, as I told you, is a shrinking of energy. So this is basically alpha exponential minus tau divided by 2 cap, but tau is given by this value. So it's going to be 1 over 2 alpha squared kappa 2 photon t cap. Sorry, not really. 2 alpha squared kappa 2 photon t cap. So basically, you have a shrinking of your coherent state and some power, alpha to the power 2k, and both sides. It's a projector of this thing. Okay? This is, so it is equal to, if you want, to some ck constant, which is given by here, that is times this thing. Okay? So I have this basically mixture of all these states, which are all the same actually, it's just that the coefficients are different, okay? So basically you get to this state somehow, okay? So your application of this error channel is just that, so basically rho zero goes to the state, which is given here, alpha is exponential. Basically, you go to this state because everything is proportional to that state. And now you turn on the two-photon pumping. This thing is very close to alpha because kappa two-photon t-cap is hopefully small, or alpha squared is large enough, basically. So this whole thing is going to become small enough, maybe smaller than alpha plus epsilon, let's say, alpha plus one-half, let's say, I told you. And which means just that if you correct, you turn on the correction now, you should go to alpha with something which is exponentially small times minus alpha, right? That's the way you can, but no, if you want to the exact calculation, it's in the notes. But basically, this is the idea. You see, over a time scale, which is given by here, you go to something which is given here. This whole thing can be written as some alpha plus epsilon. This epsilon goes to zero if alpha goes to infinity, actually. So eventually it becomes smaller than one half. And we know that for anything which is smaller than epsilon plus one half, basically you're going to convert towards alpha up alpha plus something exponentially small in alpha squared minus alpha minus alpha. So you're going to eventually correct for these kind of errors. Yes? Yes, so this is basically the tau have been chosen such that we know that if I turn on the error correction, I have had the time. It's some constant, of course, times tau. Basically, you have an exponential, some c times tau, which is needed for you to know that if you start from that point, you're going to converge towards this thing. So hopefully what it means is just that you this kind of the strategization is going to be working better and better, of course, if the kappa 2 photon times t cap is smaller and smaller. So if you have, let's say, a 2 photon dissipation, which is faster than single photon dissipation, then this is a very good approximation. But even still, again, I'm saying that this very good approximation might be not, we don't need maybe to go a factor of 10 or 100, because you see that in, for example, Zaki and Raphael's experiment, they have a factor of 1, and it still works. And the reason for that is just that as this is a stable system, the errors that you induce with this strategization are not maybe that harmful. Yes, yeah, I mean, t cap is for me 1 over 1 plus cap. So it's basically 1 over kappa 1 photon, I'm sorry, yes. Now that I have written this formulation, this is kappa 2 photon divided by kappa 1. So the whole thing is kappa 1 photon divided by 2 alpha squared kappa 2 photon. So you want this thing to be small. Kappa 1 photon divided by alpha squared kappa 2 photon, that's the thing you want to be small. In this experiment that you're going to see tomorrow, kappa 1 photon is around kappa 2 photon, so this is around 1, and alpha goes from everywhere from 1 to 5 or 6, basically, alpha squared. So from 1 to 6. Okay. So Michel's group, they had done experiments where they had gotten to a factor of 100, actually. Kappa 1 divided by kappa 2 is 1 over 100. So you can engineer quite large 2 photon dissipations. So in Zaki's experiment, Zaki and Raphael's experiment, they have basically they're working still with 2D cavities, with which could be improved in the quality factors and stuff. So even though the kappa 2 photon is quite good, the kappa 1 photon is not that good in the particular experiment. So the whole thing could be still improved. But hopefully, as I'm going to show the next lecture, we need to go to a factor of about 100 or 1,000 in this ratio so that we are at a threshold level for gates, for protected gates, logically, for topologically protected gates. So this factor of kappa 1 photon divided by kappa 2 photon is going to become very important for the gates. And we want basically to be smaller than 1 over 100. Okay. But not much smaller. Maybe a factor of 1,000 basically is quite good. We could start to see gates improving in error probability. Okay? So there is a threshold concept here. The threshold is going to be calculated for these kappa 1 photon divided by kappa 2 photon. Okay, so the same basically calculation can be done for other error mechanisms. You could consider Markovian, yes? Yes. Oh, what is the rate? So this rate is going to be given by kappa 1 photon times exponential minus c alpha squared, where c is around 2. Okay. The time of mixture between, so this bit flip rate, basically, which is meaning that the time that you get towards this mixture is going to be exponentially slow with the size of the gap. The C is the C I told you about at the beginning. I told you that there is if you start from alpha plus epsilon, you get to alpha alpha plus some exponential minus C alpha squared minus alpha, where this C depends on epsilon, basically. But for any place around 1/2 and 0, basically, if epsilon in absolute value is between 0 and 1/2, you can show that this C epsilon is around 2.
And it also depends on kappa 2.
No, it doesn't depend on, this is basically the independent thing, right? This says that if I assume I forget everything else, I have just a 2 photon driven dissipation on, and I wait, and where do I end up with? So if I start from alpha plus epsilon and alpha plus epsilon, it might take a lot of time if you had a small kappa 2 photon, but it's still, this constant doesn't depend on kappa 2 photon, it just depends on the fact that you have a driven dissipation mechanism, 2 photon driven. You have forgot about everything else. So okay. So the kappa of one photon is coming here. It's important that you have this thing. This is basically your epsilon is given by this, basically exponential of this minus thing. This is how you calculate the epsilon. Yes, this depends on the kappa of photon through that, but somehow.
Okay, yes,
of course, yes. Around. Okay, so this is basically the bit flip rate, the effective bit flip rate due to the single photon dissipation is going to be given. That's a good point. It's going to be given by exponential minus c alpha squared times kappa bone. Maybe there is actually kappa bone photon alpha squared. I'm sorry. So it could be actually this. I think this is the correct value. Actually, there is alpha squared. There is a correction of alpha squared, but that's as it's exponential in front of the polynomial. It's not as because you know that the exponential minus the overlap between two coherences is actually exponential minus four alpha squared. So if you want to use that this constant c, you might get it wrong if you use this simplified picture. Actually, what happens because of this single photon dissipation is just that you slightly distort your coherent states, and there is these are not really the two coherent states, and there is a small kind of squeezing of these coherent states that make them overlap. So it could have we could have guessed that it should be minus four even, but if we had just considered the overlap of the two coherent states, but unfortunately it's only two, which is still quite nice. Okay. So So let me just very rapidly tell you that you can do the same kind of math for another error mechanism, for other type of error mechanisms. For example, you could consider a dephasing mechanism. Which could be Markovian or non-Markovian. Let me start from a Markovian situation, and then I'll tell you what is more. What the situation we have more in the lab is the dephasing of a cavity, which happens because of a thermal excitation of another mode, which is dispersively coupled to this mode, for example. This happens much more often than a Markovian dephasing. But in both situations, we are protected. And I can show you, for example, one of them. Let me show it for the dispersive case. So if let's assume that you have. So this is a situation for people from superconducting qubits community. Maybe this is quite natural, but for everybody else, it might go fast a little bit. I apologize. So you can assume that this is your mode, which is coupled through this dispersive shift to another mode B. Okay, so this is you have a Hamiltonian of coupling between some mode A and B. This is the mode on which you're stabilized. So you have a stabilization mechanism, which is modeled by this A squared minus alpha squared. So basically, on the A mode, you have two photon dissipation, which is always on. But this Hamiltonian is always there as well. You have a coupling to another mode B, which might be pi Q or not so low Q. And the B itself is hot. So it has some thermal number of photons. So each time it excites, it's getting excited, this B mode. Basically, your cavity sees a different frequency. And it dephases. Okay, so you could ask what happens with this situation. This is a new error mechanism that I could consider. Okay, how can I protect against? Does this also protect against this kind of the bit flips due to this error mechanism? Are they also suppressed, basically? Because basically, if you still simulate this whole thing with a B in a thermal state, you're still gonna see that you're gonna have a. If you start from a coherent state alpha, you're gonna have eventually a statistical mixture of alpha and minus alpha. The question is at what rate I'm going to go to that statistical mixture. And I'm going to still show that this is going to happen at a rate which is given by exponential minus something which is exponentially small with this kind of rate, okay? Which is going to get smaller again with the same kind of protection. The idea is quite simple. The idea is just that the way you can model this mechanism is that you can say that over each time step tau, basically, I have my error mechanism is given by, let me just copy so that we don't spend too much time. Could be, you can define some new error channels. So, basically, if I look at gain. If I start from some rho of t and I wait for some amount of time tau, this whole thing can be seen as some sum of n, pn. So it could be seen as, let's say, I call it mn, rho mn dagger, where each of mn's is given by what? I'm going to just write it and I'm going to then explain it. Square root of some pn, exponential of I chi tau n a dagger a. So how do you see this? What is pn? Pn is the, if you consider the state B, basically you assume that this is in a thermal state, which is given by the states pn and n. So the state rho B basically is given by this, the thermal. So basically, what do I say? I say that with the probability Pn, I'm going to rotate with the frequency chi tau n. The cavity state is going to be rotating with this frequency, depending on the state of the cavity mode. Okay, so that's the way you could model this kind of error mechanism. Okay. So the question is that how does this? So you apply this for a time tau m, which is given by, again, by this 1 over alpha squared kappa 2 photon. And then you turn on your two-photon derivative dissipation. And then again, you do this kind of characterization again. So you just say that I have this on, this error mechanism on. Then I have correction. Then I have error mechanism on, error correction, and again and again. And again, you could start from the coherent state alpha and say, where do I end up with? And I look at this. You can do the same thing with minus alpha. OK? That's the way you could do this calculation. And basically, the calculations are in the are in the notes. You can check it out. You can still show that it's also exponentially suppressed. It's just that you have a mode. For example, you have very often you have spurious modes, or even you have unwanted modes. You need, for example, you have your harmonic oscillator. You want to measure it, so you couple it to some other thing. But this other thing is sometimes hot. I mean, it's usually hot actually. And so it means just that it's not at the in its vacuum state. So the frequency of your cavity is basically not well defined. It is defined. You have a mixture of frequencies basically, which are shifted by chi's, by multiples of chi. And this happens actually. This is basically, I would say, the second error mechanism on our harmonic oscillators in superconducting circuits. As soon as you get rid of the damping, this is the second thing that you see, I think. So it's going to be something which looks like exponential minus c alpha squared. I think we have to, yes, I haven't done the calculations exactly. But I think it should be something like, it's basically something like chi. Because as we are assuming that chi is much larger here than kappa 2 photon, basically. I mean, or of the same order. This is basically something which is going to be proportional to this, at least. I mean, there is a constant here. Oh, it might be also alpha squared here again. Chi alpha squared. Oh, and thermal of the mode B. Yes, so actually what happens is something. Okay, so I have gone actually quite fast. So what happens is just that this protection works if the n for all n's, you don't protect against all mn's, you protect all the against mn's where n becomes smaller than epsilon alpha, that epsilon is something, as I told you, is about 1/2, for example, 1/2 alpha chi over tau m, which is given by that chi kappa 2 photon. So this is basically, if you have a big population, thermal population over the states which are larger than this, they are not protected. You need to push alpha again larger and larger to protect against those. So you see, there is this is a complicated situation. So basically, you could protect against all the mn's where n is smaller than this value. For if n is larger than that value, you don't protect against those. But if you have a thermal population which is not too huge, it should be fine. Yes, exactly. So it's basically n corresponds to the time which is required so that this thing gets farther than this epsilon neighborhood that I had fixed from the beginning. That's the way you can. So if you have a huge n, which makes you rotate so fast, then that in this two photon dissipation time, basically you cannot capture it, then of course you're not protected.
Is it alpha or alpha squared?
Here?
Yeah.
I find alpha, I think. Because actually, this is alpha because this also goes as alpha. There is this distance also depends on alpha, basically. It's n, rotation angle is n pi, but the distance, which I have defined as epsilon, depends on also on alpha. So you'd see if you start from this state and you rotate the same angle, that this distance is smaller than if you rotate this state with the same angle. Well, in the kind of calculation that I'm using is the distance. It's the distance, it's not the angle. But you might be able to show actually that the angle is also good. So you might have a better prediction than this. It might be alpha squared. But this is a bound, this is a bound. Okay. Yes. Yeah, we have a proof for this, but we might be better. So these are not tight bounds, these are not tight. But these are basically somehow worst case. Yes, sufficient. Yes, exactly. Exactly. So yes, that's what we're gonna see later on. So this is true. Whatever I'm showing here is just this probability of jumps between these two coherent states, alpha and minus alpha. Unfortunately, what happens is just that when you make larger and larger cats, the probability of jumping from the plus cat into minus cat, which is the phase flip error for us, gets larger and larger. It gets larger and larger linearly. Because basically the main error mechanism which leads to that is just a single photon loss, basically. If you have a huge three photon loss, then that could be even worse. It could be in cubic. For example, if you have some error mechanism which dissipates directly with three photons, then but you can imagine that this at least is less probable than. Doesn't happen for, at least this is not the case for now, up to the point that they have measured in the experiments by Raphael and Zaki. But yes, this could be there. But still, it's going to be polynomial against something exponential. Even if you go to third, fourth, fifth, or something like that, it's still going to be polynomial against something exponential. But hopefully, it's going to be only linear. Okay. So this is some kind of protection. You could actually extend it much more. So the question you could ask, what do I have to actually induce something which is not exponentially suppressed? If I wanted to intentionally couple the two coherent states, alpha and minus alpha, it turns out that you need something very weird. You need something basically some Hamiltonian, which looks, for example, like cosine of some phi a plus a dagger. This is not very weird, of course. This is just a Hamiltonian of a Josephson junction. But if you consider this Hamiltonian with a phi a, which is as big as 2 times alpha, then you're going to directly couple the two coherent states. Do you see why? Because this thing, you can write it as exponential I phi a plus a dagger, plus exponential minus I phi a plus a dagger. And this is basically nothing other than the displacement by phi a plus some displacement by minus phi a or minus, or I, maybe I phi a and minus I phi a, something so you might. Okay? So you see that you displace your coherent state directly by a value which is huge, by value phi a, which is of order 2 alpha. So you might get directly to minus alpha. Okay, you start from a coherent state alpha. If you displace it all of a sudden because of your Hamiltonian, basically, this is not a unitary, this is a Hamiltonian I'm talking about. So if you have a Hamiltonian which couples directly two coherent states which are very far apart from each other, of course, you're not protected against such kind of perturbations. But what does this mean? It means just that you need some mode seen by junction with huge zero-point fluctuations. So basically, we can say that maybe in a natural situation where you have not engineered such a thing, this should not happen.
This is what you're pointing out, having the right
exactly, yes. And again, even if you're in such a situation, you can still push your alpha to larger values so that this is not, this remains local for that large values alpha. Okay. But this, okay, so saying that it's gonna get harder, of course. It means that you need to start from larger coherences. Okay. So I have 10 minutes left. So I wanted to also, that's right, right? I have 10 minutes left. So let me just explain very rapidly. So how do we engineer this kind of two-photon driven dissipation? So that I, the next time I can just go towards the gates and talk about the gates stuff. So we're gonna see this also in Zaki's talk tomorrow, I guess, but I wanna just maybe say, tell some basics of this. I'll leave the Zaki. Let's do Zaki too. Okay, so the general scheme is something like this. So we're gonna have a cavity, basically. I show it with this box, which is my mode A, on which I want to engineer this two-photon driven dissipation. And I couple it through something like a resistance junction to another mode B, which is very dissipative at some rate kappa B. I call it kappa B here. Okay, so it's basically a situation where you have two modes. One mode is very dissipative. This mode is hopefully very high Q. So you have a very high Q and a very low Q mode. They couple to a nonlinear element. And basically you apply some drives. So some, I show them here. You could apply it to your, actually apply it here. But so basically you apply some drives on your Jetson junction. And so what are these drives? You actually apply two of them. So one of them is what we call the pump drive, which is at frequency twice omega A minus omega B, or something close to that. I'm going to get the exact value. It's close to this value. So frequency of A minus frequency of B. And the second drive, which is close to frequency of this mode. Okay. So let me just explain very rapidly what this mechanism does. So basically, you have a four-way mixing property here happening. So basically, you have this pump frequency omega P. And this drive frequency omega D, which create two photons at frequency omega A. So this is basically the two photon driving of your system. Or the same mechanism happens. So we have basically the two photons of the cavity A coming in, creating a one photon at frequency of the pump, and one photon at frequency of the, let me just show it this way, at the frequency of the B mode, which dissipates through this channel, through this channel. So basically what happens is just that your, this mechanism engineers a two photon dissipation, because two photons get converted towards a single photon of the B mode and gets dissipated. And this one, these two photons are converted to two photons of the cavity at mode at frequency A, and they drive the cavity with two photons. Okay, so this is basically the general picture. Now, how this is actually done in practice, and how is it mathematically, how we can make this more rigorous, basically. You can do some calculations. I don't have, I think, that much time to do that. But basically, the data knows there are enough details on this. But basically, what happens is just that you can do basically the calculation for a if you have a single Josephson junction there. What you engineer is some kind of Hamiltonian, which looks like this. So you engineer actually an effective master equation, which looks like d rho of dt, d rho over dt equals to minus some h effective rho, I'm gonna write what it is, plus some dissipation of the mode b, okay? So basically this is the Limbledian. Sorry? Oh yeah, I'm sorry. OK. Okay, so yes, so I have this basically master equation where you have this dissipation of the mode B and then some effective Hamiltonian there. And what is this effective Hamiltonian? This effective Hamiltonian actually is given by three parts. Some detuning, there's some Hamiltonian of Kerr terms, and some Hamiltonian of the two photon exchange. So I'm going to just write them very rapidly, and I'm going to explain very rapidly what they are. So this is basically, the first one is omega A minus omega P plus omega D divided by 2 minus some chi AB psi P squared. I'm going to just explain what they are later on. Omega B minus omega T. Hamiltonian of Kerr is something which looks like this. A dagger squared A squared minus chi BB over 2 B dagger squared B squared minus chi AB A, B dagger B. And then Hamiltonian of the two photon exchange, which is basically what we wanted to have, which is just G two photon A squared B dagger plus complex conjugate plus epsilon d b dagger plus complex conjugate. Okay, so basically you have these three Hamiltonians. This is what we want. Whatever is remaining, we don't necessarily want. Some of them are harmful, some of them are not, some of them are actually helpful as well. But let me just, so this first one is just a detuning Hamiltonian. You can make it to be zero. Basically, you just choose m omega p and omega d in such a way that these are zero. So basically, this is just some AC Stark shift because of the pumping, this is the cavity frequency. And so you can choose omega p and omega d such that this whole thing is equal to zero. And the same way here is some kind of AC Stark shift of the mode b because of the driving, and this could be made also zero by choosing omega d. So you have two parameters, omega p and omega d, and two values that you want to make zero. So these two things, you can make them zero by choosing, well, the frequency. That's what in the experiment you do by somehow tuning, by just sweeping the frequencies and choose the best value, okay? So these two things we don't have to worry about. How about the Kerr Hamiltonian? The Kerr Hamiltonian, it turns out that these terms are actually not harmful. They are even helpful. I don't know whether Nick has a poster here. Yeah, so you're going to see in Nick's poster that this is what is behind actually the Kerr cats, which is another kind of method to stabilize cat states with only Hamiltonians without any dissipation. The protection it gives is a little bit different because it protects against basically Hamiltonian errors and also single photon dissipation. But for example, thermal excitation or dephasing are not protected in the same manner. You need to have the two photon dissipation. So it's a different mechanism, but it allows you to have faster gates. That's a very nice property of these things. If you have these kind of Kerr effects, they could be used to make your gates faster. Okay, so I'm not going to talk about this. I think you're going to have a talk by Shruti next week on this kind of thing. So this is something which we don't really care about, or it's not if you even like them. But this is a harmful thing. This cross Kerr between the two modes is not a good thing. Basically because, as I told you, this is some error mechanism. It's maybe not that harmful. It actually turns out to be quite harmful for now. And the reason for that is that this chi AB in most experiments have been even larger than this G2 photon. So basically somehow you don't see this Hamiltonian. This is actually, you cannot do basically the adiabatic elimination of the mode B and see it as a two photon dissipation. And so the nice thing that you're going to see in Raphael and Zaki's, Raphael's poster and Zaki's talk is that they have found a new circuit instead of a Judson junction such that they remove these kind of terms, but they keep these terms. So that's this also could lead to bit flips. But before that, because here I haven't mentioned to you, I told you this in presence of the two photon dissipation, but here I still have only such a system. I haven't yet shown you how to get to the two photon dissipation. There is a mode B that you need to suppress to get to effective two photon dissipation. Unfortunately, in this process, if you have a big cross Kerr, this adiabatic elimination of the mode B is not going to work well. And so that's what has been limiting a lot of experiments so far, which this limitation has been overcome in this recent experiment that you're going to see. Okay. And so, okay, so let's assume that we don't have all these bad terms. So as I showed you, I mean, this only bad term maybe for now. There are other ones at higher orders, but let's forget about them. Let's assume that you have this. Then basically what you can do is some kind of adiabatic elimination process. You can remove the mode B, which is very low Q, and get to an effective two-photon driven dissipative mechanism similar to the one I had. You could ask, in this process of adiabatic elimination, which is yet another approximation, does this exponential suppression of bit flip still hold? And the answer is fortunately yes. The reason for that is that if you consider this system with a dissipation channel of B, actually the two coherent states plus or minus alpha tensor zero of the cavity B, so this is for the mode A and this is for the mode B, they are actually still the exact steady states of this two mode system. So this approximation, even though you do an approximation, you don't change the steady states of your system. You actually just change slightly the convergence rate towards this thing. So the kappa two photon is not going to be given simply by something which is given by, so basically if you do first order calculations, this kappa two photon dissipation that I had given to you is given by four times G two photon squared divided by kappa B. If you do higher order approximations, you're going to have to add some correction to this. So you change the effective kappa two photon, but you don't change the fact that you converge toward these two coherent states. That's an important property, that this adiabatic elimination does not affect basically this protection. Okay, so I think I'm going to stop here. And the next lecture is going to be about gates. How can we do gates on this cat, and then how can we put them on a repetition code, linear repetition code, basically, let's say a 3-qubit code, and then do fully protected gates on this, or even the fully protected topological gates, or even for non-Clifford ones.